So good morning again, everyone. I'm going to talk about two very serious sort of sequela of chronic CSF leaks that doesn't have too much to do with headache. You know, in the title, it says bvFTD, BA, and it's like as if everybody would know what that means. And that just shows you that I think, you know, particularly in our conferences, right, we're all like super fascinated by CSF leaks, but, you know, that's not shared by 99.99% of other physicians. So as Dr. Wang and Dr. Friedman already alluded to, and we all know, headache is, you know, by far the most important and the most frequent symptom of SIH. And when we tabulated that in about 200 patients who we saw in a certain year, you know, it says 98.5% of people have headache. But that's not necessarily, you know, an acute headache or even a present headache or an active headache. It could also just be, you know, a history of headache. And then, as you know, I think Dr. Wang already showed this slide, there are quite a few other non-headache related symptoms that patients mention. And again, it doesn't have to be an active symptom. It can also just be a history of a certain symptom. And I'll just talk about these two: behavioral variant frontotemporal dementia and then bibrachial atrophy. So what is behavioral variant frontotemporal dementia? That's really an idiopathic disease. It's genetically based. It often runs in the family. It's incurable. It's manifested by progressive deterioration in personality, social comportment. I think comportment just means behavior, and cognition, right? And when these people get an MRI scan, you see very severe atrophy of both frontal and temporal lobes. Like I said, it's incurable. It's a horrible disease, and most people don't live more than a few years after the diagnosis is made. Now, a couple of months ago, there was a famous actor in the news who has frontotemporal dementia, but he does not have a CSF leak. He actually does not have this behavioral variant. There also are other variants of frontotemporal dementia that we will not go into. So it was quite remarkable that now, and it's already two decades ago, that Dr. Hong and his friends published a single case report of a patient with severe brain sagging who was found to have a CSF leak, who had symptoms totally indistinguishable of those symptoms of behavioral variant frontotemporal dementia. And since that was published, we've seen more and more of these patients. And in order to make the diagnosis, you can look up these different diagnostic criteria. The clinical diagnosis is just based on symptomatology. And it's mainly behavioral disinhibition, it's apathy or inertia, loss of empathy, preservative behavior, and hyperorality. And then when you do neuropsych testing, there's usually loss in executive functioning. So it's usually, you know, as we all know, it's difficult to capture, you know, any type of behavioral disinhibition in your patient. You know, they might have been on the news or something like that, but it's difficult to capture it during an exam. But that happened with this particular patient. All right.
Can you hold it straight out?
Hey, douche, that's what I'm trying to do.
Oh.
So, you know, obviously he has more going on than just that. And, you know, for those not in America, that word that he used, that's really not something you would ever say to anybody in polite company. By the way, this was not directed at me. This was directed at his father. So another feature of this is apathy, right? Or inertia. So that's an example here.
What can you say?
I can't say, Mom. How come? I don't know. Yeah. You don't know? Savannah, Ray Wolf. Yeah, was up in the mountains. Yeah, and he came down looking for toast. Yeah.
This is what he does all day now.
Yeah. So as you can imagine, we only see these people who are neurologically devastated if they have a super supportive family or friend system, right? Because otherwise they won't show up in your office. You know, I think a lot of these patients are either in jail or they're in nursing homes. And this is another example. So this gentleman would literally sit in a chair doing nothing for 2 or 3 hours. Another typical type of inertia is that, you know, they'll like keep on brushing their teeth for 10, 20, 30, 40 minutes, unless somebody tells them to stop doing that. So that's the apathy and inertia. Another symptom is this preservative behavior. And Dr. Schmalman, who's a neurologist at MGH, called that ROFBs, which stands for repetitive obsessive flexion and breath holding in sagging brain syndrome. And this is an example of this flexion that people do. It's at the trunk, it's at a very acute angle, and they just keep doing that. I don't have a real good example of breath holding, but it's something like that. But then usually it lasts a little bit longer. And then even though, you know, it looks like these people are devastated and at maybe even the end of their life, right? Like this gentleman. So if you're lucky enough and you find a leak, or, you know, you do some other procedure that's indicated for a CSF leak patient, actually can do really well.
I felt better after my surgery and I'm doing really.
So, you know, unfortunately, we usually are not able to detect the leak in these patients. So we've had the opportunity to see quite a few of those patients. And I think part of it is just about, you know, publishing that in the literature. We saw a lot of patients after one of our patients was featured in the New York Times magazine. And we've seen about 51 patients with this. The mean age is, as you can see, it's in the sixth decade of life, right? So that's like the typical age for a frontotemporal dementia. Only one of these patients had an obvious leak that you could see on a spine MRI or that you could have seen on a CT myelogram. 13 patients had this specific type of leak that's called a CSF venous fistula. But in most of these patients, we were not able to actually detect the spinal CSF leak. So that either means that our technology isn't good enough yet, or it means that maybe there's some other way that there's just not enough CSF within the spinal space. This is from our first, I think, 29 patients, and it's a really busy graph, but what I want you to pay attention to is like the dark blue, that's the time period of typical SIH symptoms, right? So usually they present with a headache, and then later on, after months, years, that headache kind of goes away. And then they start with their symptoms of behavioral variant frontotemporal dementia. But, you know, they're also an occasional patient who just has frontotemporal dementia symptoms and never really has a symptom related to SIH otherwise. And what's interesting is that, and it's a small minority, but some of these patients, right, they are like the videos I showed you. But then within minutes or hours of lying down, they appear to be totally normal. And then within a few minutes to hours of getting up, they revert to their state of frontotemporal dementia. Obviously, you don't see that in the idiopathic form of frontotemporal dementia. Something that's always present in these patients is this daytime hypersomnolence. We've seen that in everybody with brain sagging and frontotemporal dementia. But there also are a lot of other symptoms that you can see with sagging brain syndrome. This lady does not have frontotemporal dementia, but she does have severe brain sagging. And one of the things is that their speech is really slowed and it has an altered pitch. And this lady also has some tremors.
Now, you said it's not 100% true. So you think perhaps it's not going to get better?
And then after surgery.
Okay. This journey has taken 4 years. Dr. Schievink has helped
me. And you can see that, yeah, she still has this sort of hyperactivity in her hands, but, you know, certainly her speech is a lot better. All right. And then that was that gentleman who was somewhat disinhibited and, you know, his dystonia resolved after surgery. Now, there are some really common barriers, right, to making this diagnosis. And I think the most common one is just misinterpreting the brain MRI. So invariably, these patients have really severe brain sagging. And we think that at least partially that can explain their symptomatology in that the connecting pathways of the frontal and temporal lobe are disrupted, but maybe something else is going on. And I think Dr. Studley might be talking about that later today. But these are two patients with frontal temporal dementia, severe brain sagging. Both of them were diagnosed with a congenital midbrain malformation. One of them was treated with a VP shunt. I think that patient, you know, passed away shortly after that procedure. And then this patient was diagnosed actually with a midbrain glioma, and they were going to do a biopsy at first. They thought, I will just radiate it. And then they happened to have a really good neuroradiologist at their brain tumor board, and he said, oh, this is not a glioma. This is brain sagging. Another barrier, and that's really, you know, really more on us, is that it's really difficult to find the source of the spinal loss of CSF. And in our most recent study, we found that really only in about 2 out of 5 people are we able to detect the exact location and type of the spinal fluid leak. So now bibrachial amyotrophy, that's a totally different disease. It's a progressive painless weakness and atrophy, almost always affecting the musculature of the shoulders and the upper extremities. In the end, it's always bilateral, but in the beginning, it may be just unilateral. And certainly the muscular weakness and atrophy can be asymmetric. Oftentimes they have fasciculation, so it's no surprise that oftentimes these patients are diagnosed with amyotrophic lateral sclerosis or Lou Gehrig's disease, or, you know, person in the barrel syndrome. And it's always associated with a very extensive extradural CSF collection. So unlike frontotemporal dementia brain sagging, where we almost never see that, in bibrachial amyotrophy, we always see that. These are just some examples of that. Here you can see that there's, you know, tremendous loss of musculature in the shoulders and upper extremities. This lady has, you know, there's almost no muscle left in her upper extremities. This was a young gentleman who actually had his leak at age 19. Then he developed the bibrachial amyotrophy. You can see that although after surgery, there was some improvement, there's a lot of atrophy still in the hand musculature, but he was able to, you know, become a police officer. Sometimes it's a little bit easier to show on a video. Like that gentleman. And then this lady, you know, it's almost like she has flippers because she really has no muscular strength in her arms at all. So we've seen 20 patients with this disorder. So it's, you know, it's really rare. That's like 20 out of, you know, more than 1,800. 5 patients really had no history of an orthostatic headache or other symptom of SIH. So we don't really know the relationship between the onset of the leak and when this bibrachial amyotrophy starts. But for the other patients, the mean age of onset of SIH symptoms was pretty young. They were only, the mean age was only 26. You know, there's a pretty good range. But in 5 patients, their CSF leak started in adolescence. And oftentimes there's a, you know, more or less trivial type of traumatic event that precedes that. And the interval between when the CSF leak starts and when the symptoms and signs of bibrachial amyotrophy starts, it's pretty wide. In our series, it's as early as 1 year and as late as 39 years later. But on average, it's about a decade. So on average, there's about a decade between when the leak starts and when bibrachial amyotrophy starts. And we do think that the results of fixing the leak are much better if you get to it, you know, the sooner the better, but the cutoff seems to be about 10 years. We know a little bit about what the actual risk is of developing bibrachial amyotrophy. So we studied a group of patients with leaks in front of the spinal cord, ventral leaks, we'll talk about that later. And then we found that about 20% of those patients after 15 years had developed bibrachial amyotrophy. But, you know, to be honest with you, that's only 2 patients out of the 60, I think, that we followed. So, you know, it's not totally negligible, but, you know, obviously it's not that common either. You know, unlike superficial siderosis, so this is superficial siderosis on the left, and Dr. Harris will talk about that later. In superficial siderosis, right, there's about a 50% chance of developing that after about 15 years. So what are the common barriers for not making the diagnosis of bibrachial amyotrophy? I think really the most common one, and you know, these are examples that are pretty recent, is that it's just not recognized on the MRI scan. So for example, on the left side, and actually the neurologist wrote on the indication, is there a CSF leak? Because he really suspected a CSF leak. And unfortunately, this MRI, even though you can see the ventral collection, there's a C12 retrospinal collection. It was read as a normal scan. This was that police officer that I showed you earlier. And then this one in the middle, as you can see here, right, there's a pretty large ventral collection that was read as degenerative disc disease. So that patient ended up with a cervical discectomy infusion. And then this MRI scan on the right side, you can see the extradural CSF. But this happened after a fall, so that was read as an epidural hematoma, and that patient underwent pretty extensive spinal and cerebral angiography before the correct diagnosis was made. And the other kind of typical thing that we've seen is that, you know, people recognize that there's a ventral collection, but it's interpreted as showing some type of congenital cyst, like you can see here, right? These are ventral leaks. Some of them are, you know, very large. And they say, yeah, that could not cause just bibrachial amyotrophy, right? Either it would be a myelopathy. But so the reason that people get this is that this collection in front of the spinal cord really stretches out the cervical and upper thoracic nerve roots. And actually, not all of these patients have a leak in front of the spinal cord. It can also be on the side of the spinal cord. And then another common barrier, and that's really more onto us, is that sometimes it's difficult to localize the exact leak site, or sometimes people, of course, don't even look at it. So this is somebody who had bibrachial amyotrophy. It was recognized. It was recognized that it was, you know, probably related to this extradural CSF collection. So the neurosurgeon just did a cervical laminectomy. There was a lot of leaking, but of course that kept going on. Then they did a cervical discectomy infusion. They saw a big extradural CSF collection. They squirted in some blood and glue. That didn't fix it. Then they did another surgery that required a fusion. They couldn't find it. And as you can tell here on the CT scan, there's a little dot of calcium of bone there. And that's actually what had caused the leak. This is from surgery. And then, you know, pretty soon after surgery, that extradural CSF collection resolves. So they both have in common that there's an insidious onset, right? It's not an acute onset of symptoms. Headache, by the time that they get these complications, usually is not very prominent anymore. Oftentimes it's misdiagnosed. But what's very different is that with frontotemporal dementia, there's almost never any extradural CSF, but with bibrachial amyotrophy, there's always a lot of extradural CSF present. All right, thank you.